Hi, everyone. Welcome to the North Texas Teen Book Festival, hashtag NTTBF21. And this is the Novels in Verse panel. We're really excited to have all of these brilliant authors, poets with us today. I'm Rebecca Marsick. I'm a secondary literacy coach here in Fairfield, Connecticut. And while we're not in person for the festival this year, we're really thankful that the home of NTTBF Irving, Texas is still able to provide such a robust online festival for our authors, for the students. So we're really hoping, and we know you'll enjoy the panel this evening. And with that, I'm going to ask the authors to introduce themselves and their books that they are going to be talking about tonight. Evie, would you like to start?
Yeah, thank you, Rebecca, and thank you to the North Texas Teen Book Festival for having us. I love this festival, and it's one of my favorites. So I am E.B. Zoboi, and I am co-author of Punching the Air with my friend, my brother, Yusef Salaam. This is my fifth book. I'm the author of Pride and American Street, and the editor of Black Enough. And I met Yusef in college, and I ran into him again at a book festival very much like this one 4 years ago. And we decided to work on this book together because we have such a long history as teens growing up in New York City. I'll let Yusef let you know who he is. And when that terrible incident happened to him, I was in elementary school and I read about it in a newspaper. And then he walked into my college classroom and we had a very long conversation, mostly about a particular man who served as president for 4 years, but he's no longer president. Thank goodness. But ultimately, we wrote this book together to honor the exonerated five, to honor boys who get caught up in the system, to honor boys who are artists, who have a voice, who have a passion for life. But America and its injustices and its just its view of Black boys and Black bodies in general towards those dreams. So, yeah, Punching the Air is a book. Yusef, I'm back on to you.
Oh my goodness. Listen, you know, Punching the Air, this is really a love offering, I think, from me and Evie to the world so that we can really change the world. It's about using the experiences, tragic or not, that allow us to speak life into the world in a really, really powerful way. I'm one of the back then I was known as the Central Park Five, and you know, one of five boys railroaded by the system, run over by the spike wheels of justice, and really wasn't supposed to survive. You know, the charge that they gave us was a charge where we were convicted of rape, and it was assumed that we would die in prison. And if we miraculously survived, they hoped that we would not have any kind of success in society, that we would die social deaths. And every door of success was being shut in our faces. And I remember when I walked into that classroom that Evie is talking about, it was 2 years after I was released, and the professor just looked at me. She said, "I knew you didn't do it." And she held my face and hugged me, and it felt so welcoming and wanting and I mean, psychosocially, I was beginning to know that I mattered again, you know, and to be able to work on this project with Evie and for the world to be responding in such a powerful way. Here we are, right, at the North Texas Book Festival. And man, I feel like I made it.
That's so beautiful.
Thank you.
My name is Ellen Hagan. I'm a poet, performer, and educator. I'm here at the North Texas Teen Book Festival. It feels like a joy to be with you all too in this space. I'll be sharing a little bit from Reckless Glorious Girl. It is my first middle grade novel in verse. It follows Beatrice Miller, who's a seventh grader in Bardstown, Kentucky, a very small town in Kentucky. She is on the verge of 13. She lives with her mom and her grandmother, who she calls Mama. It is a country book about figuring out who you are and asking all the questions that that matter and that hold your heart, and figuring out how she can show up her true self and also, you know, be a little bit cool too and a little bit in the world. But that's Reckless Glorious Girl.
Nice. Thank you. My name is Mahogany L. Browne, and I'm a poet, writer, organizer living in Brooklyn by way of Oakland, California. I am the author of Chlorine Sky, my very first YA novel. Oh, thank y'all for letting me do that. I hope it felt like a discotheque to you. this book is, it centers a young Black girl growing up, and the idea for it being in verse was to not only give voice that is authentically a young person's, which is authentically surrounded and soundtracked by music and hip hop, but also it doesn't, in centering her, it doesn't have all the answers figured out. It's just trying to see who you are, especially in the midst of fractured friendships, especially as a product of a single parent household, especially as a survivor of someone whose parent is in mass incarceration. And so I'm looking at all those different ways in which the stories intersect for the protagonist and how she finds out, figures out who she is next to her best friend. Or is she her best friend? It's a good question. So you're gonna have to find out. You're gonna have to read the book, babe.
My name is Safia Elhillo. I am so happy to be in the company of heroes at the North Texas Teen Book Festival. My novel in verse is called Home is Not a Country. It is my first work of fiction, and it is my first book for young readers. I also have a book of poems called The January Children, and I've co-edited an anthology called Halal If You Hear Me. And with this novel, I just wanted to make a love letter to the diasporic communities I grew up in. I am Sudanese from Washington, DC, currently living in Oakland, California, and just was raised kind of all over for the first few years of my life. But the one constant, even when the literal nation around me was not a constant, was just the communities that just managed to like make a place that felt like home for me in every city that I went through. And I think it really kind of reset my idea of what belonging and identity even means. And I wanted to make an offering to those people to thank them for making me.
Thank you. I feel like that you've all spoken sort of to the theme of my first question, which is for all of you, and that you all write about young people learning about themselves in different ways and in different situations, but this idea of identity and learning about who you are as a young person. So I'm wondering, how do you decide what the strengths and weaknesses of your characters will be? And then how do you use the structure of verse to convey these? And anyone is welcome to start who has a thought first.
I'll start first. I'll start by saying that Punching the Air is inspired by Yusef as a 16-year-old boy, and the strengths and flaws. I know this isn't common for novels. Usually authors are, you know, usually say that it is semi-autobiographical. This is not quite semi-autobiographical, but it is inspired by just my conversations with Yusef. And for me as a co-author, I'm bringing in my relationships with boys during a certain time in New York City. I was a teenager in the 90s during the Rockefeller drug laws. And before working on this book with Yusef, I would go back to, like, I had a list of boyfriends, and I would go back to see where everybody's at, just a quick rudimentary Google, and to see how many of the young men that I knew growing up in New York City had a brush with the law, were incarcerated for short periods of time, had something to do with criminality, anything, you know, petty crimes. Now marijuana is legalized. I can't help but think about all the brothers I knew who served time for something that is just like arbitrarily thrown away now. So I'm bringing in my experience and knowing the young men in my life, their strength and their weaknesses, and my conversations with Yusef as a real person who experienced a certain kind of injustice.
I guess I'll go next. I think one of the things that I hope for in sharing story is that somebody gets the opportunity to understand that they were born on purpose and with a purpose. Because, you know, when you look at life and you look at the experiences that we have to climb out of sometimes, we don't often get the opportunity to hear the words of a person that I call a great philosopher, Cardi B, who says, "Knock me down 9 times, I'll get up 10. But I think life prepares you and life is shaping you. And I think the more you get up, the more you grow through something as opposed to just go through something. And being able to speak life into Amal was also me understanding my situation as I was locked away, that they had, that hope was in the prison, and I had to get the hope. I had to find it. I had to search for it. And the beautiful thing about it is that telling this story in this way gives me the opportunity to really dive into many facets of not just my life, but also other lives that I've experienced while I was in prison, different stories that people were telling me about in terms of their experience. And the hope is that the seeds that are planted causes people to become their ancestors' wildest dreams as opposed to their ancestors' wildest nightmares.
And I'll add that the character's name is Amal, and Amal means hope in Arabic. So that's why, the strength and weaknesses are embedded in the name. That's why I like thinking about our characters' names.
Yeah.
When I think about the strengths and weaknesses of the characters for Clawing Sky, I turn really to my time teaching, being a teaching artist in New York City. I walked into a classroom and I was a guest poet, but I walked into the middle of a conversation where they were arguing about team light skin, team dark skin. And that blew my mind, because in this day and age, I thought that was done with, right? Like I graduated from high school in 1994. In that moment, seeing that happen, I realized the conversation was still happening. The same things that I grappled with when I was a young person were still happening. And I thought, well, maybe the conversation isn't available to them. Maybe they don't know how to articulate. Maybe that, you know, maybe that's the story that's missing. And so I thought back to the moment when I unlearned loving myself, and that is what opens this story for Chlorine Sky. I wanted to make sure that I didn't just show this strong basketball player, but also this vulnerable, sweet young person who just wanted to be a friend, just wanted to be claimed as a friend, just wanted to be remembered, just wanted her name said, which really doesn't even happen until the last page of the book. So I pulled from inspiration around me. I pulled from the young people who I see surviving and thriving every day.
I think also I'll go with what Mahogany was saying, that idea of being in classrooms too, that the young people that I work with are always moving and shifting the way I want to shape young people on the page. You know, you want whole and nuanced and complicated characters, because that's how we are, you know? So I want the characters to come alive in different ways and not feel hemmed in by perfection or feel like they can make mistakes and they can grapple with things and through things. I was in a seventh grade classroom. It's similar, but they were asking, they were looking at Pablo Neruda's Book of Questions. And the seventh grade think of all kinds of fantastical and wild questions. And so some of them were like, will I ever get to go to Japan? And then some were like around, will, you know, injustices ever end, and racism? And they were around these huge themes and things they wanted to stop. And then some were about, will I ever get a first kiss? I was at a small table. And so to think that you're carrying all of these traumas in the world right next to getting a first kiss or getting, you know, or love or having your heart broken. I think I want characters who can live in the world like all of us do and figure out and grapple with those complications and how to show up their true selves or how to figure out who they really are. And I think that's what I'm trying to do.
Mm-hmm. I was thinking a lot about, I you know, grew up in a very communal culture where just the like operative pronoun is we, and you know, we for better or for worse are each other's business, know all of each other's business, So I'm thinking a lot about, in particularly the generation of Sudani kids that I grew up with in the DC area, the kind of like chronic nostalgia that we all shared was just so pervasive in all of us, where that like there was this like romanticizing, not necessarily of like the geographic homeland, but of the past and of a moment in time that could not be acted on, could not be changed, and that we had no agency over. And so it was very easy to fall into this thinking of, oh, if I had only been born in a different time or in a different country, all the things that hurt me now would not hurt me, instead of like trying to think about ways in which we could be more agent in the lives that we had been given. And so it was, I think, a means of escape that I am still guilty of reaching for in moments where I like do not want to take on the responsibility of living my own life. I'm like, oh, if only, you know, I were somewhere else or I was someone else. But I think the strength is kind of, the strength and the weakness feel like two sides of the same coin, where I think community is strength. I think being accountable to your people is strength. I think it is a responsibility and a kind of love, and I think I am better for it. I think it, in my character, in Ni'ma, I think she just has such a generosity to her that I really love about her, where it's like she's going through her own thing. She has her own like really heavy stuff to carry, but she's also always like checking over there to see like, are the people that I love okay? What can I do to make it so that they're happier and so that their sadness is less pervasive? Is there anything that I can change that can make it so that it's easier for them?
So your answers all just made me realize what a terrible question that was, because it's not really about strengths and weaknesses. It's about like the complexities, the layers, the richness of characters, right? Like strengths and weaknesses feels too definitive. So thank you. That was beautiful. Evie and Yusef, you've talked about how Punching the Air is based off of Yusef's experiences as an adolescent. And I actually read an NPR interview that I thought was really interesting, where you talked about how you focused on collaborating on the characters more than the plot. And I was just curious about your process of writing together, as you know, it was, I'm assuming, a pretty personal take for you, Yusef, and how you work together as authors in terms of determining language, dialogue, descriptions, the verse, and conveying those characters.
Can I start that part? I always say that she's the DJ, I'm the rapper. And I say that because, you know, coming from the spaces that we came from, learning about ourselves in a really rich and powerful way in college, it gave us the opportunity to understand that underneath everything was the drum, right? And the drum was what kept the rhythm and the beat, and it allowed for the words to become alive. And so as I would tell my story, or I would talk about things as it related to my experience, you know, what I found, which was really powerful, was that Evie was able to massage it all into what it needed to be in order to make this into Punching the Air. You know, sometimes I would talk in a circle about something. Sometimes I would go way over there and then come back. And it really is telling the full story, but then you had to have someone who had the ability to mix it all into a song, Punching the Air.
As you can hear, Yusef speaks like an elder, in the way that there is deep wisdom. So in talking about what story we're going to tell, I wasn't getting the, okay, this is what needs to happen next, and this is what needs to happen next, something that would make up a plot. I was getting hindsight. I was getting big picture analyses and emotional deep dives. And I'm like, oh, that's not a story. That's characterization. So of course, this is a character-driven story. And I'm happy for it, because sometimes we get caught up in the minutia of a crime or, well, how did this kid get there? You know, the drama of the courtroom. And we did not want this to be the courtroom drama. This is the internal journey of a boy, simply because this is how Yusef talked about his journey. It was just revelatory. It was just insightful. And we had to create a character who's just as insightful, even while he's having his dark moments. He can see the big picture, and there's something that he's moving towards. And that is the hope that this is going to be get better. I may not be getting out tomorrow or next week or next month, but there's something that I have that I can hold on to get me through the next day. And this is exactly how Yusef talked about his journey. And my task was to take that and put it in poetry form several times over.
Sounds like you're a perfect collaborator. So I'll be waiting to see when the next book comes out. Mahogany, Safia, and Ellen, in your books, I feel like the relationships with other characters are so central to your protagonist's identity journeys. And I'm wondering, how did you decide who these secondary characters would be so that they would support your protagonist in this journey? And then how did you create their unique voices when writing in verse?
So my main character's bestie is the neighbor boy whose name is Haytham. And he, first of all, was so much fun to write. The book is pretty sad, it's pretty heavy, and it's nice to have one character who's just like, main thing is that he's funny and he's full of mischief. So it always, like, writing him and then reading over his scenes were like the bright spots in that manuscript for me every time. I don't know if I'm allowed to have favorites, but he's my favorite kind of. and I think it was really important for, it felt very important for me to write a friendship at the heart of this story that is so much about a very lonely teenage girl trying to like understand her identity in the greater scheme of things. But to know that like maybe the answers about belonging and identity don't exist for her on a larger scale of like nation, but in her interpersonal relationships, she's had homes there the whole time. And so I think it felt very important for me to like build out that relationship as one of her homes, to build her relationship with her mother as one of her homes. Her mother and Haytham's mother are besties from back home. So it was also important for me to like have, even though all these characters are carrying so much and are kind of moving through their own sorts of isolation, they do still have these little pockets in their world where they are safe, where they are held, where they do belong. So even if it's not necessarily a microcosm for what's going on in the bigger world, it's a way of imagining what it could look like on that scale because it exists on the small interpersonal scale.
I love that idea of relationships as homes. That's such a beautiful image. And I think in for Reckless Glorious Girl, you know, Beatrice has two best friends, Mariella and Stacey Ann, who she's grown up with since they were young people, you know, children. And I think, you know, part of the conflict is they're figuring out they're staying in girlhood. It's the childhood versus I'm about to be a teenager, or I'm about to go through puberty, or I'm about to go through a changing body and a changing landscape in both my mind and the physicality of it. So I think for her, those central relationships, you know, they're connected to her bike riding and to nature and building a treehouse and to being in the creek bed. And being in, you know, I wanted them to have that freedom and sort of a looseness to their relationship that felt loving and beautiful and that they were, you know, holding each other. I think that's when I think about friendships, especially around girlhood. I have a lot of community of women and people around me who are holding me up always. So I wanted that to be in there too, in the book. And she is trying to figure out a different crowd that she wants to be with, but I think her continuing to go back to Mariella and Stacey Ann is figuring out that thread to real friendship. And so writing them was a lot of fun too. They play around. I think the physicality, they're on the swim team. They're doing, you know, they're I think rowdy in a way. So I liked that the physicality of them on the page and writing their dialogue back and forth and singing, they're in the car backseat singing. And so those parts felt like they were celebrating their friendship too, in a way.
I love the celebration of friendship. That was centered in Chlorine Sky. More specifically, I was interested in mirroring platonic friendships and romantic friendships, romantic relationships, and showing how both of those actually have the same weight in someone's life. So the loss of a friendship can feel like the loss of, you know, a love or a family member. And so the you can't tell if I wanted the reader to fall into the book and not know if they were upset with Laylee, the best friend, or if they were Laylee, the best friend. You know what I mean? And I want, because we all are villains at some points in our life, and we don't mean to be, but just not considering someone can be that moment where you're like, oh, I let someone down. And when you're thinking of friendships, I wanted us to like really dive in and dig in to the moment of who is worthy of being judged in this moment? None of us, right? So how do you show up as your best self? And I wanted that to keep coming back because you see the protagonist really pining over this friend's approval. Just the same way you pine over approval from a parent or a mentor, that is the same kind of ebb and flow that happens in the book. And I thought it was important to show how strong it can make you, but also how, if you aren't careful, it can break you. Mm-hmm. I totally did not mean to rhyme, y'all. I am sorry. It is how novel and verse is showing up, isn't it?
Well, it's a perfect lead into the next question, which actually is one I was thinking of it. And then Emily from Jasper High School wrote in the same question. And she was wondering, how does writing a novel in verse differ from writing a novel in paragraphs or in prose?
I love that question. I had a hard time. I had to send a lot of SOS signals to people who have done this before, because when I got my first galley back, I thought, oh, these are just a whole bunch of poems, Mo, get it together. This is not working. But once I was able to fill in those potholes, what I love about the ability of verse is that you don't have to have a perfect ending. The idea is that you offer the snapshot and you let the reader choose their adventure. You let them unpack some of that work. And in turn, the nuance is far more richer. They get so much more from it than you ever would have gotten if you just wrote this block and said, A and B and C and D, and this is what happened. This is the landscape. You're actually painting a picture and you're asking the reader to tell you what they see.
Yeah. And I'm not sure that I knew exactly how to write a novel in verse either, and did not know that novel in verses were a thing for a little while too. I was a poet. I was writing poetry and then read, I think I read first, Ada Salazar has a book called The Moon Within about a young girl getting her period that is so beautiful. And then I read Elizabeth Acevedo's The Poet X too. And mm-hmm. I said, this is stunning. And there's breath on the page. And it feels like you can move around between poems. And I just thought that was such an exciting way to weave. You know, I feel like also I've read a lot of poetry collections that feel like they could be novels in verse. They absolutely feel like a journey through that poet's, you know, through the poems. So it felt like a natural way to it, but like Mahogany said, there were some moments where I was like, I'm not sure how I'm gonna get from here to the next thing. Or plot, you know, to figure out plot. I'm working on a YA in verse now, and I feel stronger even than I did, because it's figuring out, like, the more I read and the more I've read other, you know, this crowd of squares here, these amazing writers, like I'm starting to go, oh, you could do this in lots of exciting and different ways too. And now it feels even more energized to me as I've gotten into it more.
Love that. I first of all, I feel like verse is my only written language. If I'm writing anything in paragraphs, it's like an email and probably I'm mad. So it, like, if it was gonna be a novel at all, it was gonna be a novel in verse. And I think the reason that I feel like the power and the responsibility and the agency to even write in verse is because it, like, heals so much of my, like, bilingual, I'll never be fluent in anything trauma. where the space of the poem is like, there's so much more freedom from ideas of fluency and of like proper, correct English and syntax and everything. So it is a world unlike the rest of the worlds where I have to be a person making words, where it's a world where I get to be in charge of what the language gets to do or not do. So the grammar in the poem is this way because I said it's gonna be this way. And there's no one in there who can correct me and be like, that's not how you say that, because it's my poem. It's my language to do with as I please. And so in like venturing into narrative for the first time, I wanted to make sure I had all of my like go-to tools with me. So it would have been too much of a jump to go from just writing poems to also then trying to write a novel. And on top of that, to try and write it in paragraphs. This is like, we can't just jump off the deep end like that right away. Let me write like one full sentence ever first. But I think it also, so much of the novel is like told from the perspective of my main character's like interior world. And I feel like verse is like the perfect language for that, where it's sensory and it's not like conclusive, and it is about like asking more questions than there are answers. So it felt like the perfect kind of language to use for this like questioning teen's inner monologue.
I'm gonna have to agree with what everyone says. I don't have much to add other than the fact that the main reason why Punching the Air is a novel in verse is because of Yusef's poetry collection. He had written poems while he was incarcerated, and some of his original poems are included in Punching the Air. And it was a no-brainer, but I am grateful for the novels in verse that came out before, because I did read them to see what I could do. I did not know that we can do that. Of course, those of us who were doing spoken word many, many moons ago, right? I know what we could do with the sound, how the words, how we speak the words, right? And the cadence and the breaths in between words. I knew that we could do that, but to see it on the page through the Poet X, even Jason Reynolds' Long Way Down, and Aida Salazar's book, and Nikki Grimes had written novels in Bronx Masquerade. I went back to those books to see what can be done. And somehow, you know, not somehow, but those books gave me permission to write. And that's why I love when people do things beforehand, because it's like, okay, I could always, if an editor or someone says, no, I don't know if you can do that, or this doesn't make sense, I could go back to a book and say, aha, you can have one word on one page and it be a, like a paragraph. It can say so much. Give me my one word on the page. So I'm grateful for all of that.
That's right.
The only thing I can add to that is, you know, I wanted to be a hip hop artist, since I was 12. And one of the great things about being in New York, seeing hip hop being birthed, is that even in the absence of music, there was always a message. There was always music in the message, you know? And I think that the great thing about this book, you know, especially when EB let me know, hey, this is how we're gonna do this. I was like, oh, okay, cool. This is different. This is, you know, I hadn't yet read books like that. I was more so used to reading like paragraphs and, you know, stuff like that. But then seeing it and realizing like, there's music here, right? There's flow. I hear the bass, I hear the piano, I hear, you know, the melody playing all throughout this, you know, it's just become so powerful. So, so powerful.
Mm-hmm. No, I'm always in awe of all of you writing in verse, because it's just, it's incredible and so beautiful on the page. We'll keep going with some questions from students. We have a bunch from Jasper School. They all really were into your books. Thomas from Jasper High School asked, what are some ways that I can keep the reader engaged in my story through the use of storytelling and narration?
I
I'd say honesty. And it sounds simple and trite, but really, it is with young people that I learned the power of keeping it funky, keeping it real. They do not want, you know, the radio edited version of what you think they need to know. They want the trill stuff. And so how do you tell the truth? How do you speak it plain? And how do you leave it all on the page? I would say that's first and foremost. If you can do that, everything else is craft. Everything else is editing, but the story, the honesty, that's key.
I agree with that 100%.
Same. I would just say also characters. Like I want to be on a journey with the characters. I feel like if I can connect to those, even if I don't feel like I can see myself, but if I can see somebody I know through that character, if I can connect to that character, then I want to go on the ride with them too. I want all that honesty, but I want to be connected to that character.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, go ahead.
No, I was the only thing I was going to say about that was that I think just from the perspective of being out there in the world, right? Being introduced to the world as a 15-year-old child and then coming back into the world, being rebirthed into the world as a grown man, right? There was a disconnect sometimes. And the disconnect was that when I show up as a man sometimes, but with a 15-year-old toolkit. And to be able to describe and shape information in a way that speaks to young people, for me, was very important. You know, when Evie and I had the conversation about wanting to do this and why, it was because I was a 15-year-old child. You know, we were 14, 15, and 16-year-olds being adultified, being made into the pariahs, and being dismissed in a way. And you know, to be able to speak in that way and to give life back to that and to, you know, let young people know, like, you're not crazy. Like, you have real thoughts that are real and important and valuable, you know. And I think the earlier you are allowed to tap into that, the earlier you get the opportunity to see reflections of that, the greater you can be in the purpose that you were born for.
Thank you. Runal from Jasper High School asked, how did you know that you wanted to be a writer and what pushed you towards this career?
It was EB.
Same.
It's funny. So like the book that she was talking about is my book, Words of a Man, My Right to Be. This is the book that I wrote all throughout prison. This is my collection of poems. And really, it was just something for me to remind myself as I was going through the journey, as I was, you know, sometimes not feeling as strong at times. I would read or reread words that gave me more strength, that reminded me how I felt when I read that, you know, that I am the revolution, you know, that I was born, you know, to be able to be one of the stars, you know. But I think one of the cool things about EB and I's collaboration is that when we met each other at a specific space and time, and we were doing specific things with our lives. And then EB goes on to, you know, become who she became. And it was in that expertise that when I reconnected with EB, that the time was right, that she was like, I got you. I know exactly where you need to be. And I was like, word? Okay, cool. I'm down. You know? You know, she didn't have to twist my arm, not too much. You know what I'm saying? But I think that that's the cool part, you know, seeing this world and seeing how there's so much, like there's depth here, you know? And really the other part about being an author, which is really cool, you know, when I was in prison, you had, some people had the opportunity to purchase TVs, but TVs were very expensive and they were only in black and white, but everybody had a radio. And it was that radio and also books that allowed for the mind to become the movie screen that the words would play on, or that the author, the person speaking over the radio would play on. And you'd be like, wow, you know, you would find comfort in that. You know, it was a bit of an escape, you know. And the cool thing too is that, you know, I've always seen books to be more giving in the space of, like with a movie is like, I'm going to show you what you need to see. Whereas a book gives you the opportunity to see it for your own self and to create the character for your own self, and sometimes be the character, you know, has been talked about, you know, are you the person that is the protagonist, or are you the friend, you know, and playing in those roles and seeing how you can show up and then understand or explain or express in those spaces.
Thank you. Yeah, books are the reason I want to make books, you know? But I've been like a big reader since a very young age. The joke in my family is that the reason I still know how to drive and all my cousins know how to drive is because they like, at some point throughout all of our childhood, some uncle would take them out to the desert to teach them to drive. And my grandma would be like, leave Safia alone, she's reading. And you know, so now I'm like missing a vital life skill because I was like reading. But you know, you win some, you lose some, I guess. But my first life as a writer was in spoken word and in slam. And I think that's like what kept me a writer, where I like had like a bunch of hobbies that I would try on and drop off as a kid. I was like, I felt generally creative, but nothing would stick. So I was like really into like knitting for 2 weeks. And then I wanted to be a cartoonist for like 3 weeks. So I would pick things up and I would put them down. And the reason it stuck with the poetry is, so I grew up in Washington, DC, and there was an open mic night on Tuesdays at a place called Bus Boys and Poets. This is back when there was still just the one location on 14th and V. And a friend took me to this open mic, and it was like a window into another world. I was like, what do I have to do to keep getting invited back here, to keep getting to hang out with these weirdos? Like, I just need to like write a poem, that's it. Like, I'll write 10, I'll write 20. Just like, please let me keep coming back here. And I know there's like, you know, this like stereotype of the isolated writer as the hermit or whatever, but that's so the opposite of my experience. It like, I felt just like kind of an oddball my whole life, and then went into these poetry spaces and I was like, this, like, these are my people. These people are weird in the ways that I am weird. And so like, all right, let's be a poet then, because this is who I want to be around.
Yeah, I think I had that same feeling of being in a poetry reading and being like, we are collectively here together, and there's applause and there's energy and people are talking back to the space. You know, I came to writing really as in seventh grade, as I was just coming to realize this, that I was really a documentarian. I've kept a journal since I was 13 years old, steadily, and not, you know, written poems, not good poems, but like I wrote what I thought were poems, and I was figuring out who I was as a writer, but I was really writing about heartbreak and love and everything, you know, that was on my mind or what I was carrying with me. And then when I was 17, I went to this program called Governor School for the Arts, and Kelly Norman Ellis, Crystal Wilkinson, and then Nikki Finney, I was introduced to this group called the Appalachian Poets, who, if you looked at the dictionary, it said Appalachia and it said white residents of the Appalachian Mountains. And the Appalachian Poets, you to literally write themselves into existence and say, no, we exist, people of color are here, we are of this mountain region too. and to be taught by them. And I will forever say Kelly and Crystal and Nikki as writers who told all of us as young people, claim who you are. If you're country, be country. If you call your mama, call it. Don't hide who that is that you are. And so in their teaching, I think they were also teaching us how to exist in the world and how to be an activist with your writing and how to organize and like all the things that I was drawn to. They sort of set that in me at a very young age. And I wanted to be where the energy was and where the crowd was, you know. Yeah.
I thought I wanted to be a writer and a doctor because of the game Life. The game Life said that writers were poor and doctors were rich, because I fell in love with books so much so I stole books from the library and had to pay off the tab by volunteering. I decided I was going to do both just to keep my life in order. And then I saw blood and I was like, I'm gonna just have to work it out. So there's no more doctor in my heart. I doctored the page. But really, that is a true story, I promise. And I was used to people telling me to be quiet as a kid, be seen and not heard. And writing was the one space where no one told me to be quiet. So much so when I wrote something, my aunt would say, come and tell me what you wrote today. And that was my one chance to just share whatever ideas I had, whatever story was matriculating in my blood, whatever it was that I wanted to dream about, I put it on the page because I knew someone would listen to me then. And that was fourth grade. And I've been writing ever since.
Wow.
Great. Okay, we have very little time left. So before I end, I do have one question, a real response. So are you ready? It's really quick. We'll start Ellen, I'm going to put you on the spot. It's an easy question though. Other than your own book, what do you think this audience should read next?
To me, Love is a Revolution, Renee Watson. Was that to me? Yes.
Okay. Yes, yes. Thank you. Yes. Mahogany.
Grown by Tiffany Jackson.
Yeah. Edie.
Legend Born by Tracy Dion.
Right. Yusef.
You mean like not this book, right?
Not that book. And yes, any other book that you think this audience should read, who's watching you today? What would you recommend?
I don't know. This book that's coming out called Better Not Bitter. By Yusef.
All right. Excellent. Done. Safia.
My hope is y'all have read this already because you've had a whole year to get to it, but Clap When You Land by Elizabeth Acevedo.
Great recommendations. Thank you. So I just want to thank all of you so much for being with us today. This was a really incredible panel, and I can't wait to watch it again because I feel like there's so much more. It was really, really amazing. And I thank our audience for coming and watching today as well. And I want to just encourage you all to watch all the other awesome panels that are going to be going on with the Book Fest this week. And you can go to the NTTBF site to still get your book swag, your NTTBF swag, which I know everyone loves from the festival. And if you go to bookshop.org/shop/NTTBF, you can also purchase books, all of these brilliant authors' books and many more from that site. So thank you everyone so much for being a part of the panel, and thank our audience for watching, and have a wonderful rest of your day.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Thank you so much.
Thank you.